Is everybody in this building a child of God?
No, not in the building.
Not in the building, huh? In this room, Lord willing. Yeah. And we look here in the book of Galatians, chapter 4. In Galatians chapter 4, if you remember. Now I say that the heir, verse 1 I'm reading there, Galatians chapter 4. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all, but is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, to redeem them that were under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. And because ye are sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore, thou art no more a servant, but a son, and of a son than an heir of God through Christ. Yeah, we're children. We're it's a wonderful thing. And we've been looking at some of these ideas of being a child. And you remember here on page 2, I hope you have your sheets with you, page 2.
No, I don't have mine.
2 weeks in a row, Norman.
He's going to learn to put it in his Bible.
What happens is I leave it on my, when I wake up in the morning, to be grabbed. Well, this time I have to put it in with my computer. Thank you.
There you go. You know that I really do love you, because I'm a Yankee fan and you got a Mets shirt on. I don't know.
Well, this is Binghamton Mets.
Oh, the Binghamton Mets. That's
the B.
Okay. The B Mets. All right. So you're in good shape.
But I am a Mets fan.
They dropped that one on
here.
He's from Brooklyn.
Yeah. Being from Brooklyn. Yeah. Well, you can't root for the Brooklyn Dodgers because they're not there anymore. So.
Well, they went to San Diego.
San Francisco. Yeah. So we're looking at being a child, and remember that the. A parent-child relationship is what kind of relationship, class?
Blood.
A blood relationship. You can't change that. You know, Devin has Smith blood in him no matter what. You know, Raph's got Wright blood in him no matter what. Isn't that how it works?
Yeah.
He's got the right blood.
He's got the right
blood, yes. Yeah. That blue blood. Yeah, it's all red and it comes out. So, and when we ask Jesus Christ to be our Savior, we enter into a, what kind of relationship?
Spiritual relationship.
Covenant. Yeah, it's spiritual, it's covenant, but it's also a blood relationship, right? You know, we're saved by the blood of the Lamb. We're washed in His blood. A lot of things about the blood that are in the Bible. And remember... wasn't it Moses' wife got all upset with him? It's a bloody religion kind of thing, you know? It is, you know? God said that by the blood. So we have a blood relationship, and then we're also born into a family. And when we were born again, we were born into a family. Amen? God's family. And, of course, then there's the question that comes up, well, don't we lose our salvation? Once we sin, isn't that what happens to us? So we've got to be perfectly sinless. Now, should we strive to be sinless every day?
Yeah.
Amen. We ought to strive to. You know, if we set out to say, well, Lord, I'm going to be sinful today, that's not a good attitude. You know, Lord, I'm going to be as holy as I can be today. And... you know, maybe I'll bump my head, go into a coma, and maybe I will this whole day not sin. Wouldn't that be something? But I'm going to try. And of course, what we have here in 1 John chapter 1, 8 through 10, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sin, do you remember what the word confess means, class? Confess. What is it, Raph?
In accordance.
In accordance. In agreement. With. Okay, the C-O-N part is with in Latin, and then what's that?
And Spanish.
And Spanish, and yeah, Portuguese, and yeah, Italian, to agree with God. Agree with God that this thing is wrong. Agree with God that it's against His holy name. Agree with God that, that you've broken His laws. That's what confess means. You know what we have a tendency to do? Well, Lord, if so-and-so hadn't done that to me, I wouldn't have done that.
Yeah.
And we have to agree with God. You sinned. Wait a minute, Lord. You got to put it in perspective here. That's not confession.
Yeah. Well, there's another one too, right?
Yeah.
I didn't know what I was doing.
Right. I didn't know what I was doing.
But we can't use that because we do know what we're doing at the time.
Yes.
We didn't realize the consequences of it.
Right.
That'd be more accurate.
Yeah.
Oh, we didn't know the consequences of it.
Yeah. Yes, Devin.
Version of that on CD about the Spirit led us to do this. That should explain the immutable God.
Hey,
no. Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Sorry about the late call. We didn't know.
We didn't know till we got here. Right? I asked Wednesday night, and Pastor Horn's picture's on the back of that one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know you folks don't have one of these. We're already on page 2 in the back of it. We're getting there. And just reviewing a little bit about being a child of God. And so we confess our sins. That's what's important for us to do. Our fellowship with God is broken, and that's because He cannot tolerate sin. There's nothing that that will tolerate sin. So what happens when a child disobeys in the household? Does he cease to be your child?
No,
doesn't cease to be the child, but of course the answer here is big no. Doesn't, but you do punish the transgression. There's a difference between punishing the child and punishing the act. It's different to say to a child, "You did a stupid thing," than to say to the child, "You're stupid." Isn't there a difference?
Yeah.
That was a stupid thing you did. For a smart child like you to do that stupid thing, not good. So, we need to punish the transgression. We don't stop loving the child. We go on here. And, of course, Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 6 tells us there. I left you in 1 John, so you have to go toward the front a little ways. To Hebrews chapter 12 and verse number 6 says, "For whom the Lord loveth, He chasteneth, and scourgeth every son whom He receiveth." He scourgeth every son whom He receiveth. And, the chastening part we don't like. Isn't that right? No, don't like that. Mm-mm. But it does prove that He loves us. Yeah. So to chasten, to correct by punishment or reproof. And then on the top of the back of that sheet, the American Heritage Dictionary, I don't know where this author came up with this, but defines scourge as to inflict severe suffering, vengeance, or punishment. I thought the scourge was to get out a whip, but and to scourge, it's severe. And sometimes that's what God has to do. Sometimes, we just have to have that happen to us. So He'll do what He needs to correct our behavior. It's interesting, and I didn't find it in here. I should have. I just kind of thought of it. But, at one point, Paul said about somebody turned his body over to Satan. who me? You know, let Satan whip on him a little bit. Who? That's a tough one. That's rough. You know, but you know, he just wouldn't be corrected any other way. That's a tough thing. Wow. Mm. But whenever God corrects us, he's trying to correct us to come back into fellowship with him. You know, and that's the same way with a child. You want to correct the problem in the child so the child is a better child, better for everybody all the way around. He wants us to repent and be restored. Isn't that true? That's what he wants. Okay.
Hymenaeus and Alexander, 1 Timothy 1:20.
1 Timothy 1:20, huh? Is that where it was?
There's two places.
Yeah, I would think there's another.
Well, it's 1 Corinthians 5:5.
Yeah. Yeah.
So deliver session 1 unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh.
That's the one.
For the
yep.
Spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus.
All right, and that was 1 Corinthians 5:5. Thank you. Yeah, thank you much, class. I appreciate that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep, that the Spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So wouldn't that be something for me to call a meeting of the church? We're going to have to 1 Corinthians 5:5 someone. Who?
Never heard it done.
You've never heard it done, no?
No.
No, no, no. So, you know, but...
this guy did repent, right?
Yeah, this fella did repent. That's right. Yeah. Yeah, this guy did. Okay, so we move on here to secondly. You know, the first was how do we become a child of God? Now, this is the benefits of being a God child. It probably should be God's child, shouldn't it be? Apostrophe S. Uh-oh. Can you put an apostrophe S in there? Hmm. This is not good. That's not a good thing, is it? How's that? Isn't that fun? And it's right up there now. Oh, the benefits. Do you remember back November 16th, the call to glory had this one in there, the benefits of serving God. You remember that one? Have you heard about the credit cards with that carry great benefits? Well, I got news for you. There's only one group benefiting from credit cards, and it's not you and me. Everybody loves benefits, a little too much probably. People are offered jobs, and their first question is, what are the benefits? Don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with benefits, but I believe it would do us good this day to stop and reflect on the even greater benefits of serving God. In Psalm 103, verse 2, our text says, bless the Lord and forget not all his benefits. God bless you. There are some benefits a child of God can enjoy that the lost cannot. This is not a matter of wicked pride, but reality. Too many Christians are living a life of defeat and discouragement, all because they have forgotten the benefits of serving God. Benefits like an eternal salvation, a dying strength, privilege of supplication, forgiveness of sins, a local church, our brothers and sisters in Christ, a hope, confidence, peace, and joy unspeakable. These are just a few of the benefits in serving God. These things the lost cannot partake of. These things are reserved for only the saint of God. Yeah, benefits, right? Benefits. And of course, here it is, the hiring process. Here's all the benefits, right? If you got a paid vacation days, or what does Devin call them, PDOs or something? Isn't that what you call them?
PTOs,
yeah. Paid time off. Okay, because it could be an hour, it could be a day, it could be. Yeah, Raph calls it being laid off.
I call it unemployment.
Unemployment, yeah. Yeah, that's where you're at now, right? Today.
Yeah. The job ended
this week. Yep, it did end. Okay, so we pray you get a new one Monday. So, you know, we ask all these kinds of things. What have they got for benefits? Yes? No? Maybe? Some of you do. Psalm 68. Remember, the Psalms are about in the middle of your Bible. So Psalm 68 and verse number 19. Psalm 68:19. Blessed be the Lord, who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God of our salvation. Just pours it out. Can you picture it? I mean, he just pours out those benefits, loadeth us with benefits. You know? I mean, if your pickup truck is loaded, I mean, it's heaped up. Yeah, you know, loadeth us with benefits. Amen.
That's Amen. Selah.
Selah. Yeah, think on that. Yeah. Wow. He loadeth us with benefits. Yeah, what a benefits package we get when we ask Jesus Christ to be our Savior. Amen. Huh? Isn't that something?
What an exchange.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the child of God receives. Did you write receive down there? You get so excited.
Yeah.
Here's some of the things we get. We get a family name. Yeah, we get a family name. When you were born, your parents gave you a first name, and you also got a family name. Got a family name, the last name of the family.
In most cases.
What's that?
In most cases.
In most cases, yes. Yes, of course. Modern day, you never know, huh, Raph?
Well, I'm thinking of one little one in particular.
Right. Yeah. You're supposed to get a family name. Well, he did, but it wasn't your family. Yeah. Yeah.
They got it now.
$50,
yeah. Yep. It's incredible. So, your last name identifies you with the family, and it stays with you, that kind of thing. And I told you how my son, I know I'm repeating myself, and it wasn't that long ago, but how my son told my daughter, now when you start work, remember, you're a Calabretta, and Calabrettas work hard. I thought, wow. Isn't that something? He said that to her. You know? And she does work hard. So, now if you've ever had an older brother go to school ahead of you, or older sister go to school ahead of you, and you go to the same building, now my wife had two go ahead of her, and you know, that family name goes.
Well, this something just really set me off my head, because I was thinking, you know, my boy's last name Collins, it's like that wasn't her family's name going back, because you know, her dad's family was Black or African descent, and it's like we don't know their name, but they're trying to keep that just to spite me.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and Tisha's last name wasn't that either.
Well, it was when she was a kid. She's changed it so many times.
Isn't
that? I don't know why.
Oh, boy. Isn't that something?
Yeah, she went with her mom's and her mom's next husband or something.
Isn't that something? Okay. Yeah, because I saw that high school yearbook and it wasn't that, so yeah. All right, so that first day of school, wow, huh? The teachers, what an impression, your older brother or sister. Ah, you know, your older brother was quite the rascal. Now, Raph, you're the oldest, aren't you?
Yes, I am. I'm seven.
yeah, and you paved the way for all your brothers and sister, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, my. Anybody else want to? Yeah, any? Devin, you paved the way for your brothers.
Yeah, but I was kind of quiet.
Oh.
Uh-huh. I wasn't very loud in high school.
Not in high school.
So, but people still knew that. Well, you're one of those Smith boys.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Smith boys. Yeah. Oh, your brother did for you, huh?
It wasn't good.
Uh-huh.
It was, there go another crazy heart.
Uh-huh. Okay.
The whole family,
yep. So sometimes helpful, sometimes not. That's what we're proving there, right? As God's children, we carry a name too. And we get the name Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now we get the name Christian. And of course, we need to turn there to the book of Acts, chapter 11, verse 26. Remember, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, book of Acts. Chapter 11. And verse 26. And it says there in Acts 11:26, and when he had found him, he brought him unto Antioch. And it came to pass that a whole year they assembled themselves with the church and taught much people. And the disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. And of course, this is where we get the texts that our King James Bible is from, you know, from Antioch, where they're first called Christians. All the other texts for the perverted Bibles come from Alexandria, Egypt. You always want to come out of Egypt. The Bible always has people coming out of Egypt. But Antioch's the first place that they were called Christians.
Why are Egyptian Catholics called Coptic rather than Catholic?
I'm not sure, Raph, why they're called Coptic. They were called Coptic Jews, so maybe when they came to Christ, they were, you know, that just stuck
Coptics
with them.
Coptics are Catholic, but just for some reason it's...
Yeah.
Maybe it's just like from the traditional Catholics who came out there and just weren't it.
Yeah, I've just never researched it.
Well, I noticed that
when I was young and got recruited into becoming a Muslim when I was a kid, I learned that most of the scripts in Hadith and the Quran is basically from the Bible itself.
Right.
Just twisted. You know,
yep.
Like some things is just like left out.
Sure.
The full script.
Yep.
But basically, that's the Hadith and the Quran is based on the Bible.
On the Bible.
That's to give it credibility. Yeah. Otherwise, it's totally empty.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, like,
that's why they have a lot of confusion among the different sects.
Sure.
It says you can't be what they call sects can't separate. You know, because
right.
Don't be a mere sect. Just come together. Basically, their teaching is from the Bible. That's why you hear a lot of Muslims, they will say, well, a Christian is also a brother or you know, man of peace.
Right.
Like my grandfather would say, you can't base a whole scripture on the Sermon of the Mount.
Right.
So Muhammad had to come and be the seal of the prophets.
Yeah. It's what your grandfather teaches, yeah. Yeah. So, of course, Christian means a follower of Christ. Yeah, that's what we're supposed to be, followers of Christ. Yeah.
And you just said many will come after.
Yeah. So, of course, we don't know where the name came from. What does it mean? We don't really know those things. Some people think that it was. Well, let me go on to the next part here. So we don't know where it came from, and some people say that it was intended to be a mockery at first, you know. But it's become more than that for us. But the Bible does not say specifically, you know, who gave them the name. But they were first called that, you know. It doesn't say here. We have no idea. And, you know, we were first called Anabaptists. Mm-hmm. And that was a hateful name. And Anna means against baptism. We wouldn't baptize babies. That's always been through our history what it was. And so we were called Anabaptists, and because we're against baptizing those that don't know Christ as Savior. That's really what that comes down to. Excuse me. And so it was a name that was, you know, yeah, how do you want to call it? It was, you know, like, it was a bad name, like a, you know, I'm a derogatory name. There we go. That's what I'm looking for. So, but then, you know, it just kind of stuck with us. And then when the Protestant Reformation came about, and they still persecuted, even the Protestants persecuted the Anabaptists. And then finally, Luther, as he studied the Bible, said, you know, I think maybe they're right. Mm. You know, we need to leave them alone. And that's kind of interesting that he came to that conclusion. But by then, they'd already had the followers, and he couldn't change what was going on. So then we dropped the Anna part and just became Baptist. But there's still groups like the Mennonites and the Amish. They still consider themselves Anabaptists. You know, and if you ever meet up with a Mennonite or Amish person, you can tell them you're an Anabaptist, and they right away understand what you're talking about, because our roots, you know, both them and us come from Menno Simons, you know. So that's where Mennonites come from Menno Simons. So he was an Anabaptist, and.
Maybe John the Baptist was too.
Yeah, he was. Yes. Yeah, he was. John the Baptist was an Anabaptist.
Yep. He didn't baptize any babies.
He didn't baptize babies.
No babies. Even heard of there was like men and women being baptized.
Yep. Right. Mm-hmm. Yep.
They were going under. Never heard of kid yet.
No.
And children.
No. What?
There were children too.
Yeah, but they had to come to know Christ as Savior.
Yeah.
So when they were persecuting us, you know what they would do? They'd arrest the pastor, and they would, at low tide, they would tie him to a dock. And then they would tie his wife on the top of the dock, looking down at her husband at low tide. And then when the tide, you want to be baptized, we'll baptize you. Of course, when the high tide had come in and drowned the man. And the wife would have to watch. Yeah. Yeah, that's nice stuff they did to us.
They were pretty nice back then.
Yeah, they were real nice. So, regardless of the meaning, right? I got a big sentence there, but regardless of the meaning, we wear it proudly now. And in Acts chapter 4 and verse number 13, we read this. You know, they're examining Peter and all. And what was Peter? What was his trade?
Fisherman.
Yep.
He was
Fisherman. Was he a real educated guy?
No.
No. Wasn't educated. You know, good at fishing, but not very educated. And in Acts chapter 4, verse 13, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled, and they took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. There's the key. They had been with Jesus. And that's why we carry the name Christian the way we do. You know, of course, anymore you have to be so careful because they've made that to include even cults and all that.
Mormons.
Yeah. So we're born again, you know, blood washed, Bible believing, chicken eating Baptists. Amen. Right? Yeah. Yeah, don't forget the cornbread, Norman says. Yeah, don't forget the cornbread. Yeah. Yeah, the chicken doesn't taste quite right without the cornbread, does it? So, you know, that's where we are, that we've been with Jesus, and that's what we want to remember about this. Okay, remember Moses up on the mountain there? If you want to take a look back in Exodus chapter 34, remember, he came down from the mountain and his face shone. Remember that? Mm-hmm. Exodus chapter 34. Had to hide it. Yeah. Verse 29 of Exodus chapter 34. Genesis, Exodus. You know. And the word of God there, it says, "And it came to pass when Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in Moses' hand, when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone while he talked with him. And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come nigh him. And Moses called unto them, and Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned unto him, and Moses talked with them. And afterward all the children of Israel came nigh, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him in Mount Sinai. Until Moses had done speaking with them, he put a veil on his face." Can you imagine that? And of course it goes on, "But when Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he took the veil off until he came out. And he came out and spake unto the children of Israel that which he was commanded. And the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone. And Moses put the veil upon his face again until he went in to speak with him." You know, so, you know, he didn't know it. He wist not. We don't use that word often anymore, wist not. But, you know, that's how his face glowed. You know, there ought to be something about us that people can see. There's something different about us, something noteworthy, noticeable about us.
The way we carry ourselves.
The way we carry ourselves, the way we react to things, the words that come out of our mouth, that kind of thing. Something special. Yeah. Yep. Like my cousin asked, you know, "Don't you and your wife ever fight?" No. Yeah. No. We have, what is that? What? How did that in that? That's Swedberg. How does he say it? Oh. We have discussions. Isn't that what he said?
Sometimes we just pray about it and later on we just realize.
Yeah. So there ought to be something. They ought to see something in you that's different. Yeah. When they look at you, can they ask the question, are they followers of Jesus Christ? Are they really followers? You know, is that what they'll say about you? They're followers of Christ.
Yeah. Also, you know, Christians are not very
You got to talk a little louder for me there, Norman.
Christians are not very much judging. They, you know, judge each other.
The level of judgment is different among Christians. Yes. Yes.
I mean, and they welcome everyone to come to know God.
That's yes, yes.
But in other religions, other organizations, they you got to fit a certain criteria.
Yeah.
And then they judge you before you even get there.
Like, right,
you know,
right.
Like they don't want you there, you know, basically.
Right.
But in crisis, you know, it's shown real love.
Right. Christ is neither male nor female, you know, bond or free, mm-hmm. just, you know, Jew, Gentile, doesn't matter, color of skin doesn't make any difference. That eternal soul is the same in everybody.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly, yeah.
That's why he said, kill the body, don't worry about the soul.
That's right.
Only I can do that.
Yeah. Yeah, that's exactly right. So another benefit of being God's child is not only a family name, but an inheritance. You know, we get an inheritance. Remember what we read when we first started about we're heirs with Christ. You know, we get an inheritance. So we can be proud of the name Jesus Christ. You know, that's for sure. But we get an inheritance. So, several times Apostle Paul mentions an inheritance. We're going to take a look just at a couple of them here. The book of Romans. Remember Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, and then the book of Romans. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the book of Acts. The next book is the book of Romans, and chapter 8 and verse number 16. Romans chapter 8, verse 16 says this, "The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God," so that we know that and we understand that. And it goes on here, verse 17, "And if children, then heirs." You know, and it's a rightful heir. It's not, someone who's, you know, trying to be the heir. Mary's family knows this one woman's trying to be an heir. She's not the rightful heir, you know, and caused a lot of trouble for the family. It still isn't settled. So it says, if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Mm-hmm. What we have to go through down here compared to what we're going to get in our inheritance. Mm-hmm. Oh, me. Just incredible. You know, some great things are ahead for us. And then Ephesians, you have to go past 1st, 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians. So you got to skip over three books and come to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11 through 18. The word tells us in Ephesians 1, verse 11, "In whom also we have obtained an inheritance." Amen. Hallelujah. Right? "Being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed. Ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Wow, my, oh my, oh my, oh my. And so the Holy Spirit is just the down payment. He's the earnest. Earnest money is the down payment. If you were to go buy a car, you know, and you gave the dealer, you know, down payment, then they'd get the car ready for you and you'd drive away with it after you signed the paperwork. But you have to give them a down payment, the earnest money. You know, and that means you will earnestly pay for this thing or they'll take it away from you. But the earnest, so the Holy Spirit, when we ask Jesus to be our Savior, we get the Holy Spirit, all of him we're ever going to get immediately. We get the Holy Spirit, and he's the earnest of our inheritance. Wow. I mean, he's pretty big, and he's only the down payment. Wow. I get excited about some of that. Amen? Mm-hmm. Right? We should get excited about that. You know, we get an inheritance. And so, as children of God, we're heirs. And, you know, something in the future is going to be ours. Going to give it to us. What is our inheritance? In 1 Corinthians, back up there from Ephesians, go backward. Galatians, then 2 Corinthians, then 1 Corinthians, chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. 2 Corinthians, chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man, the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. But God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. You know, the Holy Spirit tells us a lot of these things ahead of time. You know, what great things we have. What do you think we're going to have?
Customized mansion.
A customized mansion, that's right. Yeah.
Imagine everybody in the same building with a mansion.
Yeah, with a mansion, yeah. How about streets of gold,
yeah.
You know? No need of the sun. Yeah, we're not going to have to face darkness.
No sickness or death.
No sickness or death. What is it, Raph?
Oh, I was just thinking, I saw something on, like in Southern Australia, they've got all these really exquisite mansions that are like a couple hundred feet from the ocean.
Yeah.
And the beach gets eroded more over time. These are so low level, so people are trying to say, you know, okay, you've got to either move your place or we'll demolish it once the ocean gets within 20 meters of your home. And these people in like these $5, $10 million mansions are like, no, we want to stay here.
Yeah.
Can't you protect us? And it's like, I was just thinking the mansion in heaven
won't have that issue at all, really. Remember, ladies, you'll never have to dust that mansion. No matter how many rooms are in it, you won't have to vacuum it.
Won't have to sweep it. Won't
sweep, mop, nothing. Yeah.
Don't have to cook if we don't want to.
Don't have to cook if you don't want to, huh? I don't read that in the Bible, but maybe. Yeah. I don't know. What's that?
We don't have to eat.
You don't have to eat. No, you wouldn't have to. But you'll enjoy eating. Yeah, wow. Yeah.
Here, we have a new body.
Yep, we have a new body. Yeah, that'll enjoy the mansion. Amen. So, 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 4. That's past Hebrews and James. And 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 4 says this. To an inheritance. What's the next word in your Bible there, class?
Incorruptible.
An inheritance incorruptible and undefiled and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. You know, let's just suppose that when my dad died, he left me his car. Let's just suppose that. Now, my dad died in 1993, January of 1993. So the newest car he could have left me was a 1993. Yeah. What shape do you think it'd be in about now? New York winters.
Oh,
salt on the road.
Oh, boy. Be ate up pretty much.
Yeah. Yeah. Would I get a nice decal for the back end of it and put it right on there? It says rattle trap. You know, is that what I'd put on there? Huh?
Hold it together.
Yeah, that's, yeah, to hold it together. Yeah, keep the trunk from lifting up. Yeah. Rattle trap, huh? Incorruptible. You know, a lot of things we get down here. Yeah, but up there it's going to be incorruptible, huh? That's a great thing.
No limit.
So, our inheritance is incorruptible. That's one thing about it. Incorruptible. Yes? Cannot decay. That's the word you're looking to put in at the bottom of that sheet. Cannot decay. It's imperishable. Never will spoil. You know, never go bad. I had somebody give me some apple butter one time. I like apple butter. They gave me a jar of apple butter, homemade apple butter. Oh, wow, this is delicious. Wow, I had about two spoonsful out of it, and then didn't it spoil on me? Got all moldy.
Well, that could describe our salvation as well.
Oh, yes. Yeah, our salvation, exactly.
Well, people lose it. Wow, the inheritance has eternal salvation, but our souls don't if you could lose it.
Right. Yeah.
What would they do? Well, what would God do? Divide up our inheritance among everybody else?
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. All right, questions, comments so far?
I used mine up.
Used yours out.
Well, also, when we become a Christian, he also said that the world's going to hate us.
Oh, yeah.
Just like they hated him.
Yep.
And they're going to treat us just the way they treated him.
Yeah.
And I noticed that, especially when it took me back, and I was telling y'all before that, when I first became a Christian, all my friends already knew before I was.
Yeah.
They even got down there and they hated that because of the fact that I'm doing good, I'm helping, I'm showing love, and they didn't want that. Because, see, it makes them know in their heart that they're not right with God.
Yeah.
So anyone that's coming to them that is right with God, they don't want around.
They don't. No.
No,
they don't.
It's like the evilness just comes totally out of them.
Yes.
They say you bring out the worst in me. It's like, why? Because by comparison.
It's incredible. Incredible to be a child of God. Pretty neat, isn't it? It's pretty neat.
Let your light shine.
All right, let's pray together. Father, thank you again for your grace, your mercy, for the truths that are in the Word of God, that as a child of God, we have great benefits. We're part of a family, and we thank you that as family, we can get together no matter where with other believers and be part of that family, and that's a blessing. And we thank you also for the inheritance that's ours in Christ Jesus. And Lord, one day we'll see all those benefits that we have. And so thank you for it. Lord, may others come to know Jesus Christ as Savior through us, and we'll praise you. Now may the morning service be to your glory, and we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, my dear ones.